live from the headquarters of Ramsey Solutions, broadcasting from the Pods Moving and Storage Studio, it's The Ramsey Show, where we help people build wealth, do work that they love, and create amazing relationships. I'm Ramsey personality George Camel, flying solo today. That's right, America. They left me at the helm. There's no one to stop me from making poor choices. And so it could be an interesting show. Could be my last one. It's up to you. Let's make it a good one. The number to call is 888-825-5225. That's 888-825-5225. You jump in. We'll talk about your life and your money, whatever's going on. I'm happy to be a sounding board and maybe give you some advice. But remember, it's worth what you paid for it. Let's kick it off with Clay in Perry, Georgia. Clay, what's going on?
Hey, what's going on? Thanks for taking my call.
Absolutely. How can I help?
Yes, I am, sorry, a little nervous.
It's just me, Clay. There's no one even to be scared of. I'm the least intimidating person you could meet.
Yes, I'm 20 years old, and I was wondering, I want to move out of my parents' house eventually, but I don't know how much money I need or how to do that.
Where do you want to go and why?
Just move out, just, start, like, my adult life, whatever, and just try to experience that.
Okay, cool. So are you moving out of the state? Where do you plan on going?
I'm honestly just like 20 minutes away from my parents' house. So.
Okay. And is this an apartment? Where are you going exactly?
Apartment, yeah.
Okay. And will you be living alone or with roommates?
Probably alone, most likely.
Okay. And you know exactly how much that apartment's going to cost?
Around $1,200, $1,300.
And have you looked into any other fees, like initial deposits that may be involved?
I do not know. I'm currently out of debt and I have 3-6 months saved up. So.
Oh, awesome. At 20 years old. And you're currently working, I assume?
Yeah. Yep.
Okay. Did you go to college or you just went straight to the workforce?
Straight to the workforce. I'm actually going to school in August to do electrical, be an electrician.
That is awesome. Big fan of the trades. And what are you doing right now for work?
I build storage barns, portable storage barns.
That sounds fun. What are you making doing that?
Around last year, I made 91. So about this year, probably 90, so 100.
100 grand at 20 years old with no four-year degree.
Yep.
I hope everyone in America is listening to this going, oh my gosh, maybe I shouldn't send my kid to school for a random degree they don't need that costs $300,000. Clay, you're amazing.
I appreciate it.
So you make great money, and this rent, the key we want to look for when it comes to rent is that it's about a quarter of your take-home pay. So the question becomes, do you make $4,800 a month?
Yes, about five or six take-home.
Perfect. And as long as you have the initial deposit, I don't want you touching the emergency fund if you don't have to for this, because truly it's not an emergency. So you want to make sure you have that money ready to go. So I would call up that apartment complex and say, hey, what are all of the fees involved with me getting into this apartment?
I gotcha.
And then do you have furniture?
I do not. That's, well, that's one of the things. I didn't know how much you save up for to move out or something like that for furniture and stuff like that.
Well, you can do it real cheaply. And what I did was just go on Facebook Marketplace and, you know, friends are always giving away stuff, family, Facebook groups in your neighborhood. There's even Facebook groups that are just called Buy Nothing Facebook groups where they just give away stuff.
Okay.
So I would go cheap until you need to upgrade. But really, you're out of debt with an emergency fund. If you want to buy some decent furniture online on, you know, like a Wayfair or something and really start to kick off your adult life, go for it. As long as you budget for it.
Awesome. Sounds good. Also, I have one more question.
Sure.
I have about a $40,000 truck paid off. I didn't know, is that worth keeping? Because the gas mileage on it's pretty bad and just like downgrading some, or what do you think?
Well, it's less than half of your annual income. And so as far as the rules that we set for owning things with wheels and motors, you're not above that. But if you don't need the truck and you can sell that thing for 40 grand and downgrade to something that has better fuel economy, I would do it.
Okay.
But do you need the truck for work?
No, I just like it. It's big, so big bike.
You are very impressive, sir. Most guys that don't even build storage barns say they need a truck for hauling some mulch from Lowe's twice a year.
I got you. Yeah.
So the fact that you have this level of self-awareness is inspiring.
I appreciate it.
Absolutely, man. And I'll tell you, Clay, I moved out of my parents' home at 20 years old, and I moved across the country from Boston to Mobile, Alabama. And, you know, it can be scary. Because for the first time, you're like, it's on me and I got to start paying my own bills and for the cell phone and the insurance. But it's also, it gives you so much dignity. And I'm telling you, no one understands it until you leave the house that, yes, it's scary, but there's something about not being tethered. And I love my parents. There was nothing, there wasn't animosity that caused me to move. I just knew it was time. And I wanted to step out like you are. And so Dave always says, an eagle that doesn't leave the nest is a turkey. And so I'm proud of you, man, being debt-free, having a killer job, doing this the right way. So set a budget. I'm going to go ahead and gift you every dollar. So hang on the line. Austin's going to pick up. That's our budgeting app that I personally use. And it's so helpful when you step out into your adult life, you're making money, and you want to give every single dollar an assignment. Income minus expenses equals zero. And this is huge for anyone out there who's going, all right, I'm either out of school or I'm in the workforce and I'm young and I'm just going to stay at home until, you know, I'll get my life together, until I get my finances in order. Listen, if you have an exit strategy, that's fine. If you're going, hey, mom and dad, give me 1 year. I'm going to get out of this student loan debt. I'm going to get out of this credit card debt. I'm going to pay off this car and then I'm on my way out. But I'm personally not a fan of just living with family to live with family because you can save some money. There is something that gets you out of bed in the morning when you have to pay a bill and you have to go to work and you got to kill something and drag it home that gives you a little pep in your step. And I'm not here to knock on any generation or anyone's personal living situation. And I know culturally this is a hard thing. A lot of non-American cultures, you just kind of live with family forever and you take care of each other and there's kind of this cycle that happens. But man, there is such freedom in going, it's on me now. It's on the guy in the mirror. I can't rely on mommy to cook my meals. And gosh, I wish I still could because my mom is one of the best cooks in the world. But it's on me to figure that out. And that's such a huge part of maturing and growing as a person. And I think we should all aspire to grow in all areas of our life, but especially when it comes to taking care of ourselves and taking care of our families. I think the people that are still at home at 34, they're going to have a hard time meeting someone and getting married and starting their own family and changing their family tree if they're kind of stuck and tethered. And so I kind of like the fear that comes along with getting out of the house and having to figure that out. So if that's you, I encourage you to make plans to do that. Have the exit strategy. Have the tough conversation with mom or dad. Go increase the income. Go pay off the debt so that you can start your own life. Because we need less adults who are acting like children. And Clay is such a great example of what it looks like to do this the right way. So I'm inspired by you, man. Enjoy that Every Dollar app and good luck with the move. Check out our friends at Pods Moving and Storage. As you go through that process, they'll take real, real good care of you. Hey, more of your calls coming up, America. The number is 888-825-5225. This is a show about you. We'll be right back.
We've been doing business at Ramsey for more than 30 years. By now, we're a well-oiled machine, but it wasn't always that way. Yes, we've always had a vision, always had determination, and a drive to help people. But what we didn't have was one central place to access all our numbers so that we could get further ahead or quickly see when we needed to pivot. We were always jumping back and forth between different systems and spreadsheets. So when NetSuite by Oracle helped us wrangle our revenue, inventory, expenses, and more into one place, it was a game changer. And NetSuite's number one cloud financial system can help your business gain the same visibility. Because businesses thrive on timely data. And NetSuite's real-time analytics can help your business have immediate access to your numbers daily so you always know where you stand and you can move quickly. So go to netsuite.com/Ramsey today and set up a free product tour. That's netsuite.com/Ramsey.
Welcome back to The Ramsey Show. I'm George Camel, host of the George Camel YouTube channel, co-host of Smart Money Happy Hour, and your solo host today on The Ramsey Show. It's good to be with you. Give me a call at 888-825-5225 if you want to talk about your life and your money. If you've got that burning question you've been thinking about and you're like, I could Google it, but I don't know what Google's going to give me, and I could ask my broke brother-in-law, but I know what he's going to say. I'll try to be as honest as I can without hurting feelings, which I've been known to do. Not my intention. It's just a byproduct when you tell people the truth. Well, hey, if you missed it, we had a great event called America's Labor Crisis, and that live stream is going to be broadcast on TBN on Friday, May 19th, starting at 8 p.m. Central Time. 8 p.m. Eastern Time. Sorry, it's 7 p.m. Central Time. And if you're wondering what this is all about, well, Dave Ramsey and Mike Rowe are teaming up with five best-selling authors and experts to discuss the state of work in America today. You don't want to miss this. Again, that's on TBN, Friday, May 19th, starting at 8 p.m. Eastern Time. All right, let's get to the phones. George joins us in Chicago. George, it is good to talk to another George.
Always, always. Hey, George, thanks for taking my call. So just a really quick question. My wife and I, we're getting ready for the summer because my wife, being a school teacher, it's not an option for her to get paid during the summer months. So basically, she won't get paid for the next, 3 months. And since we're on baby step number two, my question really is, I feel like we have enough savings to get us through from July to September. Should we stop doing the debt snowball, and just get through these 3 months, or do you think we'll be okay to keep paying off the debts with the increasing with the rollover, right, from the prior debts that we've been able to pay off?
Great question. So the only time I would recommend someone pause baby step two or pause the baby steps in general is what we would call storm or stork mode. Stork mode, of course, you're having a baby, let's pause and save up cash and just pile it up until mom and baby are home and healthy. And storm mode is, hey, there was an emergency we didn't know was coming. There was a medical thing, there was a job loss. But with your situation, we knew this was coming. We knew summer happens. We know teachers aren't in school during the summers. And so I would, if I were you, go, hey, what could she do over the summer to bring an income? Now, you said it's not an option. What do you mean by that?
So it used to, Chicago Public Schools, they used to allow you to get paid. They would pay your salary throughout the 12 months.
Okay.
But they stopped that 6 or 7 years ago. So, yeah.
But it's not illegal for her to earn income in other ways during the summer.
Right. No, it's not. And then the other, so usually, and I guess I should have specified, George. So usually she does work summer school.
Okay.
But this year she opted out just because she's going to be taking a surgery. And I was like, well, this would be the best time to do it. Right. Cause that way you don't have to take your vacation time or anything like that.
Got it.
So she'll probably not be able to work for a month.
Okay. So aside from that surgery and her healing up and getting better, I would be looking at ways you can increase income and she can create income during that time. And obviously there's ways she can do that as a teacher through private tutoring, maybe teaching ESL or VIB Kid or GoGo Kid or one of those kind of online platforms where she can use her skills to create money. But there's also a ton of other ways that might even make her more money. Things like childcare, dog sitting, dog walking, doing Amazon delivery and grocery delivery. Has she looked into anything like that to create income?
We haven't looked at, but I mean, those are great ideas. We haven't, but we'll definitely look into that.
Okay.
It's a great idea.
We've got a great article all about side hustles that I worked on, and I'll make sure that you get a link from our friend Austin in the booth, and I'll make sure Austin gets that link. That will help give you some ideas. But what you want to look at with these side hustles is how much time do we have? What talents do we have? And then what's the target? Mm-hmm. The target you already have set. You've got some debt to pay off. How much debt do you have?
Are you asking including the home or just
consumer
debt outside of the,
just your baby step two
consumer
debt?
Yeah. Maybe 60,000.
Okay. What kind of debt is that?
Yeah. Credit cards and student loans.
Okay. So what's your next smallest debt?
What's the next, I'm sorry.
What's the next George, smallest debt here as far as balance goes?
I want to say, hold on, I'll tell you right now. I haven't, I don't have it in front of me. I apologize.
If they're getting baby step two done, they've got the list. They've got every dollar.
Yeah, no, I have a list.
Awesome.
I don't know it by heart, but yeah, I have it right here. Okay, so the next one is So the next one isn't really that big. It's like we open up like a medical credit card, and it's only like $1,500, which we can pay off this next month easily.
Great. How much money do you guys have in the bank?
We have about $4,000 in the checking, and we have about the same in we have like a separate short-term savings account. So I want to say we have about $8,000 right now.
Okay. If I'm in your shoes, other than this surgery Noah's coming up, I would get the details on what that's going to cost us out of pocket. And aside from mm-hmm. that, whatever you have allocated for your budget for next month, plus a small buffer, maybe $500 in checking, I would love to see the rest of that savings go towards your debt and start to knock some of this out even before the surgery begins.
Yes, sir.
And so I think if you do all of that, you find ways to increase income, you're going to be able to pay this off faster. But I would not say, hey, let's pause the baby steps because she's not working in the summertime. I want to see this thing keep moving because you're going to lose momentum. Fall's going to come around. Things are going to get busy again. And all of a sudden, it's not going to become a priority in your life. And getting out of debt needs to be the number one priority for you guys right now. So we'll make sure you get that link. And for those of you listening, we will drop a link into the show notes if you're listening on podcasts and into the YouTube description over there if you guys want to get inspired and get some ideas. Thanks for the call. Joe is up next in Dayton, Ohio. Joe, welcome to the Ramsey Show.
Hey, George. How you doing?
Doing great. How can I help?
So I just wanted to wonder what your opinion of being financially ready for a single income marriage was. I wanted to see if I met those criteria, and if not, what I need to do next.
Okay. Hit me with some of your criteria. What do you have going on?
Right now, I'm single. I'm looking to start dating, but I don't want to start until I know I'm ready to.
Oh, wow. This is, you're very future thinking here. There's no lady in the life right now.
Well, there was, but she took a break to get some more school done. So I'm thinking before I get started again, I want to make sure I'm ready. So.
Okay. So you're thinking, what do I do to become financially ready? Not for a couple
right.
to get ready.
Right.
Okay. Cool.
So I make about $52,000 a year. That's, plus benefits, that's not including taxes. I have about $15,000 saved up. I have about $40,000 in private investments and a $12,000 Roth IRA.
How old are you?
I'm 21.
Oh, my goodness. How'd you do this?
Well, my dad has been a big fan of Dave Ramsey for a while, so he's been a bit of a Dave Ramsey, honestly.
So you're kind of a financial peace baby, and the apple didn't fall far from the tree.
Yeah, exactly.
You are so far ahead of most adult Americans twice or three times your age.
Oh, thank you.
Okay,
so what's credit to my dad?
So you're saying, hey, how do I get ready for marriage? I mean, financially, you're in a great spot. You don't have any debt?
No.
Okay. And what are the investments for this $40K?
So my dad has a property management company. He bought some real estate investment properties. He didn't want to use operating funds, so he borrowed from me. I'm getting paid back at 3.5.
Whoa. Okay. Well, do you rent right now?
Actually, I'm still living at home. That's part of my compensation.
Oh, cool. Okay. Well, my next goal for you, if you've got the emergency fund, you're already investing 15% of your income, I would be looking at getting a home eventually. So save up that down payment. And so when you do meet that special someone and you've got a home or even a paid for home, you will be light years ahead and on your way to building wealth.
Okay.
But, dude,
awesome. Thank you.
You are checking all the boxes. If any ladies are listening who are in your age range, they're going, how do I find a Joe out there? This guy's got it figured out. He's not trying to stay broke. He's trying to build wealth. That's who I want to hitch my ride to. So way to go, Joe. I'm proud of you, man. Thanks for the call. I'm inspired by the young people. Listen, they get a bad rap out here, but I'm getting calls from 20-year-olds, 21-year-olds who would outschool anyone out there when it comes to their money management. So I'm inspired during this episode today.
Buying a home is one of the biggest decisions of your life. You need a partner like Churchill Mortgage. Churchill is one of the highest rated lenders in the country, and they're Ramsey trusted because they do what's right for you. Churchill works with you to build a mortgage the Ramsey way, one that doesn't bust your budget, sets you up for financial success, and helps you get out of debt faster. Go to churchillmortgage.com today and get started.
This is The Ramsey Show. I'm George Camel, your host this hour. Riding solo, our crew is all over the place right now. We've got Rachel Cruz, Dr. John Deloney, and Jade Warshaw down in New York City, or I guess up in New York City, as the crow flies. And they were doing a Fox Business panel this morning, having a good time over there. I'm a little jealous, but I also get to hang out here in this wonderful studio with some wonderful people and a wonderful crowd. So who's jealous now, Rachel? But hey, we've taken a lot of calls so far from young folks in their, you know, early 20s, 2021, and this article right here is interesting. It says almost half of Gen Zs have side jobs as money fears take over, according to Deloitte. And here's the stat. 46% of Gen Zers currently have either a full-time or part-time job in addition to their main one, a new Deloitte survey shows. And the figure is slightly lower for millennials at 37%. Goes on to say side jobs are on the rise as folks struggle to make ends meet. Some of the most popular second jobs are selling products and services online, working gig economy jobs like food delivery or ride hailing, artistic outlets, or creating social media content as an influencer. Look at that. It says, while money is the top reason for having a side job, respondents also see it as a way to monetize their hobbies, unplug from their primary job, expand their networks, and in some cases, develop skills for a new career path. And of course, the survey shows that cost of living is the biggest concern, and it's especially pertinent as over half of each generation say they live paycheck to paycheck, 5% more than a year ago. So here's what this tells me. Obviously, there's a sad part to this of inflation's crazy, we're in debt like crazy, people are trying to make ends meet, so they're turning to these jobs for those reasons. But there's a byproduct of this that I love that they mentioned, which is it monetizes their hobbies. It helps them unplug from their primary job. It expands their networks and helps them develop skills for a new career path. And I lived this out in my 20s as I sat there with $40,000 in student loan debt and credit card debt going, oh my gosh, I did everything the system told me to do, everything society told me to do. I worked hard in school, got good grades so I could get into the college of my dreams, only to find out I couldn't afford the college of my dreams. And then you take out student loans to pay for it because you had to, because there's no other way. And this is how you get by and make it. And so what do you do as a 22-year-old, 23-year-old sitting there with a pile of debt and mommy and daddy aren't around to help you anymore? Well, I turned to side jobs. And of course, I got my first big boy job here at Ramsey Solutions 10 years ago, which was awesome. But I went through Financial Peace University for the first time back in 2013, and it got me fired up to pay off this $40,000. And I wanted to do it fast. And so on top of my salary, I went, what else could I be doing? And so I used my skills, my marketing know-how, and I was a second shooter for videography for weddings. I was building websites using Squarespace for small businesses and entrepreneurs and authors and speakers, charging, you know, $1,500 a website. I was driving for Uber and Lyft on the weekends instead of going out with my friends to make an extra $100, $200, $300. I also was a Nielsen family, if you know what that is, which means Nielsen, who does all the ratings for, you know, TV, media, radio, like this show. And I carried around a little beeper-sized device that would listen to all the media that I listened to, and I would get paid based on how long I had that turned on. And I cannot tell you how uncool I looked in my khaki pants carrying around a little beeper, but it made me an extra $20 a month, and it was almost no work on my end. On top of that, I was in marketing at the time, so I went, I could do some marketing consulting. And so I started doing that for those small businesses, for entrepreneurs, and helped them launch podcasts and launch books. And as I stepped into an MC and host role, I went, okay, I have talents on stage to be a host and MC. I can go do this for other events. And so I did that to help us save for a down payment when it came time for us to get a house. I also was a musician. And so I would license my music online to make some extra money that way. And, you know, sometimes it'd be $50 for a wedding video or a church's video. And sometimes it would be Ford saying, hey, we want to use your music on our YouTube channel. And I'd get a $1,500 check for one song that I had already recorded. And so there's a lot of creative ways to make money out there, depending on your talents. I have zero talents when it comes to handyman work, when it comes to cooking and baking. But some of y'all out there have amazing talent, and people will pay for those adorable smash cakes for the one-year-old's birthday party and for that wedding cake when they're on a budget and can't go to the fancy bakery. And people will pay to have light bulbs changed out because they're too lazy, they can't do it physically because they're older, have disabilities. Whatever the reason is, you would be shocked at what people are willing to pay for. And we know rich people are scared of leaves. They hire people just to blow the scary leaves away. I pay people to watch my dog, to mow my lawn, to do the electrical work that I have no clue what I'm doing, and I don't want to sit there on a Saturday watching YouTube videos from some guy named Larry who's going on for 30 minutes about how it was back in his day while trying to teach me how to change this socket out. And so get creative with this. Think about three things: your time, your talent, and your target. Time is simple. How much time do you have to devote to these side hustles? Some people, it's 2 hours. Some people, it's 20 hours. Some of y'all that are single out there and you're sitting at home figuring out who the next bachelor is going to be and who's going to get kicked off the island, y'all, there is so much work to be done out there that you can make 20, 25, 30 bucks. And beyond your time and your talent, which is what are you good at? And let me tell you, if you have a car, you are hopefully good at driving. And you can deliver packages for Amazon Flex. You can deliver groceries with Shipt or Instacart. And so beyond any having any talents or time, we all have a target. What are you doing this for? Because if you're just doing it because you're bored, that's fine. But if you're doing it because you want to get out of debt, you're going to stick to it. You're going to work harder at it. You're going to work harder for those tips. And you're going to make some good money. And I'll throw a list at you right now, rattle some off. Because a lot of you hear Dave say, go deliver pizzas. And you're like, okay, I don't want to deliver pizzas. First of all, pizza delivery can make some great money. And here's a list. Number one, working overtime. A lot of you have jobs you can work overtime. People can flip furniture. You can get that couch off Facebook Marketplace that's a little dusty, a little crusty. You get that couch for $50. You clean it up. You take better photos of it. And you can relist it for $200. Like that. You can flip things that you buy at Goodwill. You can sell old clothes on Poshmark and online. You can sell stuff on Facebook Marketplace. You can dog sit through apps like Rover. You can dog walk through an app called Wag. Childcare is a huge one. There is a huge shortage of babysitters right now, and babysitting has gotten crazy expensive. I'm hear parents saying, oh yeah, our babysitter charges $30 now an hour. $35, $40 an hour for two. And I'm going, oh my goodness, why are we not all just babysitting constantly? House cleaning. This is a huge one. You can make $100, $200 for sitting there for a few hours and scrubbing a toilet because someone else didn't want to. You can donate plasma. Josiah from our Borrowed Future documentary, this was a way he made hundreds of dollars a month for his family that helped him get out of debt. Of course, you can drive for Lyft and Uber, deliver food with Uber Eats and DoorDash, grocery delivery through Instacart and Shipt. You can teach ESL or teach through VIP Kid or Go-Go Kid. Tutoring. Cutting grass, mowing the lawn, doing the yard work, pulling the weeds, power washing, snow plowing, valet parking, bartending on the side, focus groups, research studies, retail jobs that are now paying $15 or $20 an hour. You can be a transcriptionist on sites like Rev.com where you just type out things you're hearing for money. That's a cool way to make some extra dough. Mystery shoppers. If you've got a camera and some know-how, you could do photography, videography. Graphic design work, if you've got some Photoshop skills. You can help people move, help them pack, help organize. You can be a virtual assistant. You can be a financial coach. We have a great program that trains financial coaches. And some of these financial coaches out there, they're making amazing money helping people follow the Ramsey plan. And you can make $150 a session doing that while making an impact. So don't tell me you can't. Truthfully, there are so many ways in America today to make money. So you can tell me you won't. You can make all the excuses in the world, but don't tell me that you can't make more money in America today to keep up with inflation, to get out of debt, to save the down payment, to build wealth. And that's not forever. It's a season. So ask yourself, what am I willing to do right now that's going to set me up for the long term? What am I willing to do? And none of the people that do this stuff look back with regret. Their kids watch them work hard, and those kids end up working hard because they saw mom and dad do that. So whatever that goal is, look at your time and your talent and your target and go after it and get creative and see what happens. This is the land of opportunity, and this is The Ramsey Show. Right here on The Ramsey Show. Don't call it a comeback. I'm George Camel, your host this hour, flying solo, taking your calls at 888-825-5225. And hey, if you're a new listener to the show, first of all, welcome. We are so glad you're here. We talk a whole lot of jargon on this show, like gazelle intensity and baby step 3B. And if you want to dive deeper into what all that means, what are these Ramsey baby steps, go to RamseySolutions.com and click on the Get Started button. When you do that, you'll fill out a few simple questions, and we will help you figure out the next best step for your financial journey based on where you're at today. That's RamseySolutions.com/get-started. And if you want to take it a step further, you want to dive even deeper than that, I've got a great opportunity for you. You can go through Financial Peace University and get the whole picture in just 9 lessons. And this is the same course that I went through when I first started here at Ramsey Solutions 10 years ago, and those 9 lessons changed my life. Quite literally. It gave me this paradigm shift where I went, oh my gosh, the system is designed to keep me broke. It's designed that way. That's how they like it. And when they do that, I can stay in that cycle. I can be the rat in the maze trying to keep up with this weird credit score game and use my credit cards to get the cash back because somehow that's what's going to be the ticket to wealth and freedom. And then I realized by watching Financial Peace University that there's a way out, that it's not all my fault, but it is my responsibility, that I'm going to be in control of my financial destiny. I'm not just going to have to hope for it. And then by the end of Financial Peace University, it showed me how I can buck this system completely and get financial freedom on my terms and build wealth way faster and get out of the clutches and the grip of this toxic money culture. And so I want you to join me because I'm going to be leading folks through that same class that changed my life. And get this, the average person who takes Financial Peace University becomes debt-free of all their consumer debt in less than 2 years. That could be you. And this is the proven system, everything you need to know about money in one place. And the reason you'll pay off debt faster is not just because of the advice you hear in the lessons. It's because you have a community of people in your corner. And for the first time in your life, maybe you're going, oh my gosh, I'm not alone. Other people have done stupid stuff too. And other people want to get better. And other people want to learn how to live without a credit score and get that house of their dreams the right way. And they're going to push you. They're going to hold you accountable. And I will too. We're going to encourage you. So right now, we're pouring jet fuel on the whole thing because all the Ramsey personalities are going to personally lead you through a class, and it's an honor to be one of those people. My class starts June 20th. We're going to meet twice a week for about 4.5 weeks, going through all 9 lessons. We're going to meet at 11:30 Central Time, 12:30 Eastern Time, and you do not want to miss this. You don't have to keep wandering around trying to figure out how to do this thing by yourself, hoping for the government to fix your life, hoping for student loan forgiveness to be the saving grace. So go sign up for one of our personality classes right now, whether it's mine or someone else's. I just want you guys to be a part of one of these. Go to fpu.com, sign up today. The spots are limited. That is fpu.com. All right, let's get back to the phones. Will joins us up next in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. Will, welcome to the show.
Hey, George, how are you?
I'm doing well. How are you?
I'm doing good. Thanks for taking my call.
Sure.
I'll try to be pretty brief with this. I work as a CRNA in Philadelphia, and I worked as a CRNA in Philadelphia, but I recently changed jobs, and now I work out of Allentown, Pennsylvania. The reason why I changed jobs was they were offering a very nice sign-on bonus, a change in schedule, and the retirement package is pretty awesome. They contribute 20.6% of my annual salary, free money at the end of the year. So
wow.
I was just in a kind of a predicament because taking this job means our family will have to move out of Philadelphia because it's an hour and 15 minutes each way to commute. Yes. So the schedule is nice. The retirement package is nice. The sign-on bonus would mean that we would be debt-free besides our house. And I'm just kind of in a bind of what to do. Also, we're in Philadelphia. Our area isn't really doing the best. There was just gunshots on our block.
So high crime area?
Yeah, well, it's not like high yet, but I mean, there were gunshots on our block. So.
And you've got little kids?
And I have a 13-month-old, yes.
Oh.
So it's not really the place where you can just send them out and go run around the block.
Well, what's holding you guys there? Why not just move?
Well, our mortgage is nice right now. That's a problem. Our mortgage is probably about like $1,500 a month.
Okay.
So, and I wanted to pay off all our debts first. And we will move pretty soon, but the homes in those areas are pretty high.
So if you moved towards Allentown, what would your rent be if you rented for a while?
If we rented for a while, I would assume it's around $1,200 to $1,400.
Okay. I'm not going to hang on to this life because of the mortgage. If I'm in your shoes, I don't think it's worth it. Because if you're saying the mortgage is nice, but we can rent cheaper and you could get a house later on down the road once you're debt free, do it the right way, go slow, and maybe interest rates change, maybe they don't, and maybe we refinance down the line when they do go down. But man, I think your mental health is going to deteriorate.
Yeah.
You're going to have more time with your family. You're going to have a better life. You're going to be in a safer community. You're going to have your mental health back because 2.5 hours in a car, I just don't think humans were meant for that kind of life long term. Now, we can do it for a season.
I don't think so either.
You could stick this out for 3 months, but this is no long term plan just because of the mortgage.
No.
So I'm going to start talking to my wife going, hey, we need to figure out a game plan to get out of here. Here's what I'm thinking. What do you think about this? Let's go check out that area. Let's go check out the neighborhood. Let's go find this apartment. And this is a season we're going to find ourselves in as we pay off debt. Because I'm guessing if you sold the house, you could pay off all your debt.
I think so. And we could pay off our debt now from the sign-on bonus.
That's amazing.
We could pay it off now. And then the retirement package, I will make $180 a year, so they contribute 20.6%. So that's roughly like $35,000 plus a year of free money.
That's incredible.
That's why I'm just like, okay, all the stones are in place. Let's just do it by the fall time. That's what we were thinking.
I would be making the trip to Allentown this weekend to start looking at apartments.
Yeah.
And that's a beautiful area. I've spent a lot of time over there.
Yeah, it is nice. There's some nice neighborhoods outside of Allentown and around there. Yeah.
So I would let go of the, like, I'm going to do this because of the mortgage. Because that's really the only reason I heard.
And we would be away from family a little bit. But other than that, we wouldn't be too far. It's like a half hour to 45 minutes. If we weren't to pick Allentown, if we were to be in the middle, which is still fine.
Well, they come to you now. They want to get out of the city. They want to see their 13-month-old.
Yeah.
So that's on them now for a little while.
That's true.
And maybe down the line, you go, all right, we're going back to Philadelphia one day. But my guess is you guys love it out there and you plant some roots over there.
Gotcha. Okay. Thanks, George. I appreciate it.
Thanks, man. Thanks for the call. All right. Let's take one more. We've got Jordan in Salem, Oregon. Jordan, welcome to the show. Jordan, you
Hey,
with me?
George, it's a pleasure to talk to you. Yep, I'm
you
here.
You too, man. Sorry, we're right up against the clock. Get right to the question.
So I have several credit card debts that I have stopped paying on, and they went to collections. And I'm wondering if I should try to negotiate and pay them off, or if I should just let them get cleared after 7 years, and if that will affect my credit score at all.
Yeah, it'll tank your credit score. How much debt is in collections?
Around $12,000.
How much money do you have today?
Not a lot. Around $2,000.
Okay. So number one, we need to get our savings up. I don't know that they'll negotiate with you at this point. How old are these debts?
Around 6 months old.
Okay. So they're pretty fresh. I don't think they're going to negotiate on debt that's 6 months old. If it was 6 years old, they may take $2,000 and be done with it. But right now, I would be proactively communicating with them, saying, hey, here's how much I have. It's not a lot. I'm working on it. Here's how much I can give you today.
Yeah.
But I would not give them access to your checking account. And if they do give you any numbers, get it in writing.
Yeah, absolutely.
Those are the two main things.
I'm getting married at the end of the year, and I'm trying to buy a house as soon as possible.
Dude,
so that's like my main motivator.
Right now, we got to focus on one thing at a time. Obviously, the wedding's going to happen. The home ownership dream may be delayed. We got to clean up this mess. Do you have any other debt?
Oh, for sure. For sure. No, just the credit card debts.
Okay. So let's stay out of debt, close all the accounts. Let's make some arrangements with them. Be proactive. Don't wait on them to knock on your door, metaphorically speaking. And you can look up the Fair Credit Collection Act if you want some kind of hard data on what they can legally do and can't do. But I wouldn't bank on them negotiating. I'd rather you just come up with 12 grand and be done with it, man, and quit playing this game. I'm rooting for you. That puts this hour of The Ramsey Show in the books. We'll be back before you know it. Hey, it's George Camel. If you like what you heard in this episode and want to know more about getting started on the Ramsey Baby Steps, go to RamseySolutions.com and click on the Get Started button. We'll help you figure out the best next step for you based on your specific situation. That's RamseySolutions.com and click Get Started. Live from the headquarters of Ramsey Solutions, broadcasting from the Pods Moving and Storage Studio, it's The Ramsey Show, where we help people build wealth, do work that they love, and create amazing relationships. I'm your host, George Camel, flying solo this hour as the team is off around the world, changing the world, doing amazing things. I wanted to be here with you guys. And the phone lines are open at 888-825-5225. If you want to call in with your burning money questions, maybe you saw an ad on Instagram and it felt like a scammy financial product and you're just not sure. Maybe you're trying to get out of debt and you want to know the best way. Or you want to invest, but there's so much noise out there, you don't know what to do, who to trust, and you just want to make a decision with some confidence. I want to help you make those decisions today. Janessa kicks us off in Reno, Nevada. Janessa, welcome to The Ramsey Show.
Hi, thank you so much.
Sure.
So basically, my question is, I got myself in a sticky situation. I have some financial debt with some credit cards, and I have car payments and everything. And I just want to kind of be the chain breaker of financial irresponsibility. And so I'm looking for some ways to kind of budget and really like make financial decisions properly.
I love it. That is a very noble goal and a great why.
Yeah,
so let's talk through this. So you have credit cards and car loans. How much?
Mm-hmm. So my car loan that's left is about $18,000. And then my credit cards altogether is like around $2,000.
Okay.
And then I also have a school loan as well, which I think what's left on that is like around $9,000.
Okay. And what's your income?
Let's see. So that's the thing. It's fluctuating because my school loan, I'm a licensed esthetician, and so I'm starting out my career, basically. And I am an independent contractor, so it's so up and down. I make roughly like around $700 a month.
You make $700 a month?
Yeah.
How is that possible?
Just because clientele and everything is just so not.
But you book appointments, right?
I do, yes.
So you know when you don't have appointments?
Correct.
So what are you doing when you don't have appointments?
So I, for a long time, I worked another job. Like, I worked multiple jobs.
Okay.
And usually that helps. I just am tired of being, like, at the bottom of the barrel, like, making $14 an hour to where it just doesn't really make
sense. You don't even make $14 an hour now.
No. Well, kind of. When I have, like, on my good days, I make...
You make $14 like, an hour 3 hours a week. I mean, this, you're way below the poverty level.
Yeah.
So right now, we need to get a full-time job and do your esthetician work on the side as we build that up and build up the clientele.
Mm-hmm.
And maybe that means we pack out a Saturday full of appointments, and Monday through Friday, right. We've got a full-time gig.
Yeah.
And this may be temporary. Right now, you called in saying, I'm in a mess of debt, and making $700 a month means you can't even cover rent, let alone your debt payments. That
right.
scares me.
Well, and the thing is when I did, like, I purchased my car and everything, I was working full-time. So I wasn't, like, irresponsible and like, oh, yeah, I can afford this, sure.
What were you doing before?
I was an HOA manager.
Okay. What were you making doing that?
Management. Not very much, like $16 an hour.
Okay. So this car that you've got 18 left on, what is it worth?
22.
Okay. How much money do you have in the bank total?
About $140.
Whew.
Currently, yeah.
Okay. And that's all the money to your name. That's liquid, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay. So our A1 is to go make as much money as possible very quickly. How
yeah.
are you going to cover... Do you have rent payments?
No.
Where are you living?
With my parents.
Okay. How old are you?
20.
Okay. So here's my game plan if I'm in your shoes. Right now, you have the blessing of having very little bills, which is why mm-hmm. you've been able to survive.
Mm-hmm.
Right? If you were on your own right now, you would be homeless, if we're telling the truth.
Yeah.
Or finding family or friends to live with. And so luckily, you've got a lot of time on your side, and I want you to have an amazing career as an esthetician. But right now, we've got to clean up this mess, because I feel the weight of this, and I bet you do too.
Yeah.
And so to me, that car's got to go. And that means we're going to sell it for 22. You have 18 left. That's going to leave you with $4,000, right?
Mm-hmm.
And with any other money we can scrape up, we're going to go get a $4,000 car. And can I tell you that car is going to be the worst looking car you've ever seen in your life?
Yeah.
You know how bad that car is going to look. But it's going to get yeah. you from A to B, which right now is just getting to work and back home, right?
Mm-hmm.
But guess what else that does? That means you have $2,000 in credit cards and $9,000 in student loans. That brings your debt down to 11 total.
Yeah.
And you already feel that weight leaving your body, don't you?
Yes.
And now our goal is, how do we get rid of that next smallest debt, which would be the credit cards? Do you have multiple or is it just one?
I do have multiple. My biggest one is $18,000, so that's like the chunk of it.
Hold on. You said you had $2,000 in credit cards.
Yeah, so I have the $18,000 and then, well, I guess plus...
You mean $1,800?
Yes.
Or 18...
Sorry. Yes, $1,800.
Oh, you about gave me a...
Oh,
I thought I just had a conniption.
So sorry.
I lost my breath.
$1,800.
Okay.
No, sorry.
So your next smallest debt is $1,800.
Correct.
If you sell this car, which I think this thing's gone tomorrow. We're going to clean it up, take some nice pics, and we're going to sell it private party for as much as we can get for it.
Mm-hmm.
Because right now... That car is more than you make in an entire year.
Yeah.
And it's going down in value every single day. Or it could propel you towards debt freedom if we sold it. And
right.
I want you to have a nice car down the line. When you're debt free and you have an emergency fund, we are going to get Janessa an awesome car when her career is taken off as an esthetician. And so I think right now, we can still work on the esthetician gig, but right now we need something full-time that's going to bring in a lot of money fast.
Yeah.
And that might mean three side jobs, or it might mean one full-time job making 16, 18, 20 bucks an hour.
Okay.
So that would be my next goal, is go find a full-time job while doing esthetician work on the side and building up your clientele list.
Yeah.
Because right now, there's a time to be an entrepreneur and work on building your client base. But right now, you can't even think about that when you've got debt payments coming out your eyeballs.
Right.
And so I just want you to focus on one thing at a time, because that's what's helped me get out of debt, out of $40,000 worth of debt, which is way more than you had. And, you know, I was at a starter salary, and I was doing every side gig under the sun. Anyone who would throw a buck at me, I was like, all right, I'll do. What do you need me to do? And I tried to serve them well, and they told their friends, and I got more gigs that way. And I think you're going to do the same.
Yeah, thank you.
I want to help you with this, Janessa. Hang on the line. I'm going to gift you 1 year of Financial Peace University. If you want to join my class starting June 20th, you can do that. And I'm also going to gift you 1 year of Every Dollar Plus to start making a plan for every single one of those dollars, whether it's $700 or $7,000, you're going to have a plan. And right now, that plan is to pay off all of this debt while you have the blessing of living at home with very little expenses. So I'm cheering you on. Please call us back when you're debt-free, and we'll celebrate with you. This is The Ramsey Show.
Y'all, there's a lot you can't control when it comes to healthcare, but there is something you should check out that can help. Christian Healthcare Ministries. CHM is not insurance. It is budget-friendly, biblically-based health cost sharing. That means a community of members helping share the burden of each other's healthcare costs. They help people just like you in all 50 states. So see if CHM could be right for your family. Learn more today at chministries.org/budget.
Welcome back to The Ramsey Show. I'm George Camel. The number to call is 888-825-5225. You jump in, we'll talk about life and money. Listen, if you're listening to the show, I assume that you enjoy it. And if you do enjoy it, please consider hitting the subscribe button or the follow button wherever you're hanging out with us. Leave a review, let us know what you think of the show, and share it with a friend. And all of that is not for our own validation and approval and ego. It's so that the algorithm spreads the word about the show, other people hear about the show, other people are impacted. And if it means one other person becomes debt-free and finds freedom from this toxic money culture, that is a win in my book. And also, if you're a fan of the show, you might like my brand new YouTube channel, where we're publishing new episodes Mondays, Wednesdays, and Fridays, 3 a week, and they are short, they're funny. They are hopefully helpful as we break down some of these money trends and traps that you all are asking me about, sending me videos about. We just had a video this week about Apple's new trick to get you to spend more through their high-yield savings account and their credit card. And we also cover money traps that are keeping the middle class broke. I react to some of Steve Harvey's money advice from Family Feud. We talk about how your car is robbing you of $6 million. So much stuff. So go check it out. We've got tons of videos out there. And thank you to all of you who have already subscribed and those of you who have viewed the videos. We hit 1 million views just in the last month alone. So thank you so much. The response to this has been incredible. And I encourage you guys to go check that out. Hit the subscribe button and tell your friends. Apparently, kids really love this show. I don't know why. I would rate it as a PG show, you know?
Hey, my mom texted me yesterday that she loves your channel.
James Childs, our producer, his mom loves the show. That means the world. Oh my goodness. So there's something for everyone here. Whether you're, you know, you're 6 or you're 56, everyone loves it. So I appreciate that. We try to deliver the goods with our amazing team of editors and writers and audio engineers and the video guys. It's a spectacle to behold how much effort it takes to give you guys some great content. Let's get to the phones. Robin joins us in Orlando, Florida. Up next, Robin. How you doing?
I'm doing well. How are you?
Doing great. How can I help?
I am trying to figure out when is a good time to start saving for a house. We have $190,000 in debt, and we just want to know when we can start saving for a house or if we need to get all of our debt paid before we start saving for a house.
I can't breathe thinking about having a mortgage on top of $190,000 in consumer debt.
Yes, it's a lot.
Doesn't that feel like a lot?
It is a lot. It is.
What kind of debt is this?
$100,000 of it is student loans. $60,000 is our cars, and $12,000 is credit card.
Okay.
And then I have like $4,000 in taxes that I'm currently paying.
Okay. And what's the household income?
We make currently $190,000 a year.
Love
and
it.
Plus extra with all of the side gigs my husband does.
That is wonderful. Okay, so the good news is you guys have a big shovel.
Yes.
The bad news is we have a load of manure to clean up before we get into home ownership. And here's why. It's not because I'm legalistic and I'm like, you got to follow the rent. It's because we take too many calls of the Robins that call in and they go, hey, we just got a house. It was our dream. We thought it was going to be this huge blessing and we can't breathe. We have $190,000 in consumer debt. The mortgage, $250,000. By the time the bills are paid, we can barely eat. And that is my fear for you guys. Even with a great income, you can out-earn your stupidity for a while. But, man, it'll drag you down having all those payments.
Yes.
So what are your monthly payments just on your debt? Just the minimum payments.
We just started the baby steps on this month. But our minimums are, I think all together, it's like $3,000 is our minimums on all of our debt.
Okay, and what's your take-home pay each month?
Each month we bring in about $15,000.
Love it. Okay, that tells me there's plenty of margin to start attacking this debt.
So, yes, just this month we paid $4,000 in credit card debt off.
Awesome. So you're following the Ramsey plan, you're on board, but you're like, hey, I really want to get a house. Do we have to wait till this debt's paid off?
Yeah, it's because we're in a weird situation with our house. Our friend / my husband's boss / our homeowner is the person that owns the house.
Oh, it's all the same person.
It's all the same person.
So that would be like, and you're renting. So it'd be like me renting from Dave Ramsey.
Yes, and he is great. He doesn't give us any hard time, and he doesn't care what happens to the house. But I would just like to be out of that situation just so it doesn't ruin a friendship.
Well, why don't you guys go rent somewhere else while you pay off this debt?
Because the rent in Orlando is ridiculously high.
So you're getting a deal right
and
now.
And we have a kid and a dog. Yeah, we're paying what he pays for his mortgage.
Oh, my goodness. So you want to have the cake and eat it too, Robin. Is that what's going on here?
Yes, I would love to.
Well, here's the thing. I think the dream of home ownership is on the horizon, but I think we need to pause and go, how quickly could we clean up this mess? Making $190,000, how quickly can you pay off $190,000? What's your guess?
The plan that I originally had, of all the $190,000, it was up to 4 years to pay it all off.
I don't buy it. You guys can do better than that.
And that was being very
Can you live off of 90?
Yeah, we could for sure live off of 90.
So you could throw 100 total per year at 190,000. That's less than 2 years.
Yes, we could definitely do that.
So we just halved the debt-free timeline.
We're going. Yes.
Of course, there's taxes. So this is napkin math, but I'm going, hey, if you did the extra side gigs, we live off nothing, we pause all investing, we sell everything that's not tied down, how much quicker can we do this? Because think about this. Now the goal is if we pay this off faster, we get into that new home faster. If we get into the new home now we're kind of comfortable while also being uncomfortable because we're stressed, but we have the house, but yet our life kind of sucks. You see the other side here? Versus 24 months from now, we're in a different place. Do you guys have any cash?
Yeah, we just have $4,000 in the bank account. I cleared as much as I could out without bankrupting us.
Okay. The other option here, I don't know that you'll do it. I don't know that you're going to like it, but you could sell the cars and get cheaper cars.
We're upside down in the cars.
Okay. But still, even if you had to get a loan from a credit union to cover the difference, that would put you in $10,000 worth of debt instead of 60, right?
That's true, yeah.
So that still clears 50 grand very quickly. And remember, 2 years from now, or less now, if we sold the cars, we're debt-free, then we're going to get that emergency fund in place real quick, in less than 6 months is what it takes on average. Then we can start saving up for that down payment. And then making 200 plus, how quickly could you save up a down payment if you didn't have any payments in the world?
Very quickly.
Less than 2 years.
Yes. And I am about to start working, because I'm currently not working. That's just on my husband. I am going to start working in September.
Awesome. What do you think you'll make?
$52,000 a year.
52?
$52,000.
Awesome. Mm-hmm. So now think about this, Robin. 2 years from now, we're debt-free. 6 months later, emergency fund. Less than 2 years after that, we've got the full down payment. Which means 4 years from now, you're in a completely different place financially. And that's without even your income getting added to this. So there's your options. We can get into the house today and have it be a curse instead of a blessing. Or we can hit pause and have some delayed gratification and go, man, it's going to be such a different picture if we do this slow and do it the right way. And that's what I want for you.
I will do that. Should I start saving any money now, or should I just wait till it's all the debt's paid?
All the money is going towards the debt. What I found is when I focus on 17 things at once, I kind of suck at all of them. And when I put all of my energy, spiritually, emotionally, physically, mentally, financially, towards one thing, that thing gets busted through real quick. And that's what happens. That's why people follow our plan. It's not a magic plan. It's just because we're stopping doing 17 things at once and we're going, this debt is gone tomorrow. And that next debt is gone the next day. And all of a sudden, you start building wealth, you start feeling the peace, and you become debt free. Thanks so much for the call. This is The Ramsey Show.
If you're like most people, your home is your most valuable asset. And when you want to make improvements, it can feel like everything costs too much or takes too long. But something as simple as custom window coverings from Blinds.com can completely change your space and add value to your home. We've recommended Blinds.com for over a decade, so you know you can trust them. From blinds, drapes, and shutters to motorized shades, they make it easy and affordable to upgrade your entire home, and their team is ready to help with everything from design consultation to measuring and installation. Plus, there are never any misleading quotes or hidden fees. Everything's backed by their 100% satisfaction guarantee, and shipping is always free. See why Blinds.com is the number one online retailer of custom window coverings. Go to Blinds.com now and save 40% off selected products. Visit Blinds.com today for more info.
This is The Ramsey Show. I'm George Camel, hosting solo this hour. Give me a call at 888-825-5225. We'll talk about your life and your money. Our question of the day is brought to you by Neighborly, your hub for home services. With 19 service brands nationwide, their network of providers have trusted local service professionals to handle more than 1,000 different services in and around your home. Visit neighborly.com to find and schedule service today. Today's question comes from Jimmy in Rhode Island. He asks, is PayPal trustworthy to keep doing my online banking? I've been using it for over a year now and haven't had any issues. I noticed they have a PayPal savings now. It has a 4.15% APY. Seems high for just a savings account. Maybe there are some details I'm missing. I want to put $10,000 in it and see what happens. I'm not ready to invest the $10,000 completely, so to me this seems like a smart move. What are your thoughts? Great question, Jimmy. Okay, so what he's talking about here is using PayPal as a sort of banking system. Now, PayPal itself is not a bank. They do partner with other banks like Bancorp and Synchrony Bank to provide products like some prepaid debit cards, credit cards, lines of credit, lots of debt products that I would never recommend you go towards. But they also now have a savings account, which is also going to be backed by Synchrony Bank, which is member FDIC, which means it's insured up to $250,000 per depositor, per account, per ownership category. And so there's nothing wrong with having it as a savings account. I would, however, not use it as a checking account because it's really not a checking account. I would just use a traditional bank to do my checking. And here's why. They don't have the same features. They're not backed the same way. So really what you're doing is you have a PayPal balance and you're kind of using that as a checking account, which just doesn't make sense from a budgeting perspective, from a personal finance perspective. So I would stick with a checking account. I like to have a local brick and mortar bank or credit union I can go to. If a problem arises, I can talk to someone face to face. But I also like to have an online high yield savings account. Now, I don't trust PayPal just on a level of there's been too many issues, scams, frozen accounts, money disappearing, eBay scams that are connected to PayPal. And so if I were you, I just wouldn't put my money there as a savings account. You can get 4.15% these days at other places like Marcus or Ally. And again, those are going to be FDIC insured as well, so your money's safe there. But I wouldn't be using, it'd be like using Venmo as your checking account. it's just not a good way to do it, and you got to hope you have the money, and you can do better than that, Jimmy. But great question. Love it. All right, let's go to Mike in Philadelphia. Mike, welcome to the Ramsey Show.
Hi, how are you doing?
Doing great. What's going on with you?
All right. So yesterday, my sister called me and said her car broke down. My wife and I do really well financially, and my sister's been doing great on her own financially. Her husband passed away probably 4 or 5 years ago. So she's a single mom of three, and she says to me, she's like, I don't have enough money to buy a new car. So I'd love to help her out, and I don't know if it's, like, the best idea, because I have probably $15,000. I could just write her a check today. Here you go. I don't think she wants to buy a $15,000 car. So she's looking in that $30,000 range. And I could give her the money, but I don't have it today. Probably take me another 2 months to get up to that point. And I don't know if I'd be doing her a disservice to say, hey, listen, I'm just going to give you $15,000 today, take out a car loan, or option B, buy a $15,000 car, and then, you know, you probably have to sell it in a year or two. I feel like that's kind of a waste of money. So I just don't know. And I called the Ramsey Show because I know you guys like to say, you know, live like no one else, so you can give like no one else. I'm just not quite ready to, you know, like all of my bills have been paid, and that happened about a year ago. And we've been saving, but we're not at the point where we can just give a $30,000 gift.
Sure.
At a moment's notice.
Is this the first time she's asked for money?
Yeah, she didn't even ask for money. She just said, I need some help. Maybe you could help me look for a car. She thinks she wants to go get a car loan. I'm like, I really don't want you to get a car loan. And, you know, for the position that we're in, I'm almost tempted to be like, okay, listen, get a car loan. And then, you know, I'll give you $15,000 for a down payment. And then in, you know, 3 months, I'll just pay the loan off.
I don't like any of this, Mike. There's got to be another option here. So what's wrong with the car currently?
So her car is a 2007 with like 200,000 miles on it, and the engine blew yesterday.
Okay, so what's the cost for repair?
She's a single. It was like, I think they said it was like $3,500.
Okay, and what's the car worth? If you, let's say you put the engine back in.
You did $500. It's basically worth scrap.
Okay.
It's all pinged up, and she, you know, she's got.
But
three
if you
boys.
Put $3,500 in, would that thing run for another 50,000 miles?
I have no idea. And that, you know, but we could do that, and I just feel like that's wasting $3,500.
So we're going to waste $30,000 instead.
On a car?
Yeah, I mean, that feels like a crazy jump. Did she say she wants a $30,000 car? Where did these numbers come from?
Yeah, so she's like, I want to get. Oh, she was looking at a used Honda Pilot.
Okay.
And, you know, like 40,000 miles, relatively new. It was like in that 30,000 neighborhood. And okay. I'm like, that's a pretty good car. I feel comfortable with you driving it. Like I said, she's got the kids. And honestly, I'd love to give it to her. And I just really haven't been focused on saving cash. So it's like, if I just focus for 2 or 3 months, boom, I just write her the check. Here you go.
Do you guys have no debt and a fully funded emergency fund?
Yeah. Okay. Even my checking account's pretty good. So we paid off the house. We don't have a mortgage.
Awesome.
We don't have any student loans.
So, Mike, what's the end game for her? That's what I'm worried about. What happens when she has another bill and another emergency and she goes, hey, Mike,
so
man.
My sister's been doing great. She's been doing great. So her husband passed away 2 years ago.
Okay.
And she's been doing great. Financially, she's not in debt. She still has a mortgage, and she has a $10,000 emergency fund. So she was saying, I'm going to use the emergency fund. This is an emergency.
Okay.
And I'm like, yeah, all right. So, you know, maybe she uses the emergency fund. I help her out a little. We get a little bit of a cheaper car. But I'm like, I just want to do this. And I feel like I'm just right at the finish line. You know, if she said this to me in September, I would be like, here's a car. Here are the keys.
Here's what I would do in your shoes, Mike. She has an emergency fund. I want her to have skin in the game. And I also don't want her to go into debt. So the condition for you giving her this money, it would be, this is a gift. I'm going to give you $15,000. You your emergency fund on top of that to get the car you want, but do not go into debt. And you go with and you help her negotiate, and you help her get that car. But we're not going to go into debt. We don't need a $30,000 car because we've been driving around a clunker. It doesn't work like that.
I think
what's her income?
Dave Ramsey says when you give family, like, you don't give family a loan, you just give them.
I never said do a loan. I said this is a gift under the condition we don't go into debt for a car. So you're not asking for the money back, but she's also putting in 10.
So she, and then she just doesn't have an emergency fund.
She rebuilds
like $75,000.
So she rebuilds the emergency fund over the next 6 months, 3 months, whatever it takes, and we're back. I don't see the problem here.
So you think just, like, don't worry about getting the car. That really that she wants it, I think it would be good for her.
What's good for her?
Well, so, getting a bigger vehicle that's reliable.
Oh, my
gosh.
And
then you don't have to think about...
Guess what? An older Honda Pilot with 100,000 miles is just as reliable. You pay for the inspection by a reputable mechanic. It's going to cost you $100-$150. And they go, hey, it's in great shape. This thing will go 250,000 miles. But this idea that we need to get the 2019 Honda Pilot because it's got the TV in the back, I'm not buying that. And so I think we get the older car that we can pay for in cash. That's reasonable. And I don't want a gift to turn into an enabler.
Use her emergency fund?
This is an emergency. She needs a new car. And then from then on, you go, hey, we're going to set up a sinking fund. We're going to put money away every month because we know we're going to need a car eventually. So that's what I would do in your shoes. You do what you want to do, but I would not go into debt and I would not go buy a $30,000 car and I wouldn't use my money to do it. That would turn a gift into enabling, and that part scares me a little bit. But thanks for the call, Mike. This is The Ramsey Show. To The Ramsey Show. I'm George Campbell, hosting solo today. Keep me company. Give me a call. 888-825-5225 is the number to call. We'll talk about your life and your money. You know what would be awesome? Never having to use my own money to buy stuff. Wouldn't that be nice? And while that's never going to happen for me, it could happen for you because we are giving you the chance to win some of Dave Ramsey's money in the Ramsey Cash Giveaway. All month long, you can enter to win up to $500 or the grand prize of $3,000. For real. All you got to do is go to RamseySolutions.com/giveaway. And bonus, you can enter every single day to increase your chance of winning. No purchase necessary, but you got to be 18 or older to win. And today just keeps getting better because our $10 sale is back. And right now, you can get all the books and tools you need to start building wealth, find a career you love, improve your mental health, and deepen your relationships. Wouldn't that be nice? The $10 sale includes Dave's latest book, Baby Steps Millionaires, that lays out the stories of real people, including teachers, who became millionaires using the baby steps, and you can do this too. That's some deep, life-changing stuff for the cost of a trip to Chipotle. So shop the $10 sale today at RamseySolutions.com/store. Danielle joins us up next in Pittsburgh. Danielle, welcome to the show. How you doing?
Great. How are you?
Great. How can I help today?
So my husband and I are on the journey. We're on baby step number 2, and we've paid off about $40,000 in debt, and we're on our car loan now that's about 21 grand, and then we also have a mortgage as well as a second mortgage that's actually for a building that my husband owns for his small business. But the question that I had for you guys today, or for you for that matter, is just trying to navigate, paying off this debt, but knowing that my husband's a small business owner, we haven't been touching any of the money or kind of like earnings. We normally only take a little bit out of there as we need. We've been using my income, but we now have, enough money sitting in his bank account, from, his great work that could be paying off some of this debt. I'm just not quite sure how to navigate that.
Yeah. So what is this, all these retained earnings for? What's he saving up for with this business?
So we originally were thinking about making some changes to the building. But, you know, in talking about it, it's not going to really bring in extra income, and I don't think it's worth it.
Agreed.
So the other thing was just trying to, like, hold on to it, knowing that, like, he just really doesn't want to take it out, knowing that we'd be paying taxes on it. And if there's another opportunity, whether it's to pay down, you know, the business loan or mortgage that he has on the building, or, you know, if it is smarter to put it back into the building. But I'm like, we're also sitting on this car loan.
How is he not paying taxes on it?
I think it's just a matter of, like, normally at the end of the year, we have the conversation where I'm like, okay, here's what we're sitting on. Do we want to throw this into
But I mean, it's not stocks. This is earned income. This is revenue, right? So you got to report all of this on the taxes.
Well, I think that's where, like, we tend to meet with the accountant throughout the year to be like, okay, is there anything else we want to be investing in, whether it's, you know, putting another, he's a barber, he owns a barber shop. It's putting another chair in, whether it's additional advertising. Like, we tend to play around with the expenses to say, okay, do we want to dump this back in, which is where there was the conversation around, like, fixing up the back room, updating the bathroom, putting in, you know, putting on new asphalt, things like that.
Got it.
None of it is, like, immediate, though. But that's tends to be what we're doing.
How much money is in this account?
Right now, $28,000.
And what's your total debt load that's left? You just have the car loan, right? The mortgages we're going to put in baby step six. That's later on.
Yeah, so right now the car has just about $21,000.
So I would pay off the car today, and you still have $7,000 left in his savings account for the business. And as long as he doesn't need any retained earnings, I mean, you can start chugging away at the mortgage too. But his income counts as y'all's income, and so I would use it towards your shared goals, which includes paying off the house early.
Yeah, so I guess the point too would be just, like, setting aside enough for taxes, knowing that we're using this for personal stuff, but even then we'd still have enough to pay it off.
Is he filing quarterly estimated taxes right now?
He is, yeah.
Okay. So I would make sure we have enough to cover this next quarter, but you're for sure going to have enough right now to just pay off the car.
Okay.
And unless he has a specific goal he's saving towards in the business and some retained earnings for whatever, you know, the expenses may be in that business, I would be using it to further yourselves in the baby steps and get that emergency fund in place. Do you guys have any other cash outside of that $28,000?
No, we've kept it to a minimum, trying to dump it all on debt.
Okay.
So we just have, like, you know, our little baby emergency.
So maybe
fund
the next thing is we pay off the car. That's 21. We use another 5 to get our emergency fund going for baby step 3. Keep fully funding that with future income. And then beyond that, we're going to be at 4, 5, 6. So we should be investing 15% of our income into retirement and paying off the house early.
And then should we be treating the business loan on the building the same way we treat the mortgage then?
Yeah, I would probably focus on paying off your mortgage first, depending on the numbers, if they're equal and you want to attack the business mortgage. But I'm going to just put them all in that kind of baby step 6 category once we get rid of this consumer debt.
Okay. No, that's really helpful. Thank you.
Awesome. Thanks so much, Danielle. Great question. We love a barber. I love my barber. He started his own business and branched off, and we need those entrepreneurs in this world today. All right, let's go to Landon in Columbus, Ohio. Landon, welcome to the show.
Hey, thanks for taking my call.
Sure.
Just got a kind of a similar question. Me and my wife's a stay-at-home mom. I make annually $180,000+ a year.
Awesome.
Debt I have is my mortgage, which I owe $157 on. And then I have a car loan that I was probably young and dumb and bought. I've just followed you guys about 5 months, and I'm trying to figure out whether I should keep the car and pay it off or trade it in for something less in value and start banging out the house.
Okay, what's left on the car loan?
So the car loan was a Chevy Tahoe, and I owe $57 on.
And that's your only vehicle, or do you have multiple?
We have another vehicle that's paid off, just a Ford Fusion.
What's that
paid
worth?
Paid off a little bit now. About $15,000.
Okay. So as far as the numbers go, you know, these cars still don't add up to half your income, which is kind of our parameters for things with wheels and motors in them. So they're not killing you, but I also feel like you don't need the Tahoe and you're kind of sick of making these payments and you want to be debt-free faster. Is that fair?
Right. Our goal is to pay off the house, but We bought Tahoe so we can haul the family and kids around. You know,
how many kids you got?
Two kids.
So we you need a Tahoe for two kids?
No, that's what
I thought you were
going to
say you got six kids.
No, two kids. So we don't need it. That's what we can settle for less.
A CRV can haul two kids.
Right.
So yeah,
I don't know if it'd be wise to trade it in and settle for less, or just since it's my only debt other than the house, try to hurry up.
Well, what would the Tahoe sell for?
Probably about what I own. I haven't owned it that long. Probably about 3 months I've owned it.
Okay. And how much money do you have outside of that? Do you have any money in the bank?
Yeah, emergency fund in the bank. I have about $17,000.
Okay. So if you sold this thing for $57,000, that leaves you with $0 owed and no car. So I would use some of that money you have sitting in savings to go get you a car, and that might mean you save for another month or two, and we downgrade to an SUV for now.
I have another car. So we got that Fusion that I was talking about, and my wife's a stay-at-home, so she's not really going anywhere if I'm at work.
Have you talked to her about that? That worries me that she can't leave the house because you're at work.
That's what we talked about. Maybe find just a little crappy work traveler car for me, and then she can keep the Fusion.
Okay, that sounds better.
You know, maybe spending no more than like.
Mama's always got to have the nicer car. That's a rule.
Right.
Man, if you're willing to make that kind of sacrifice, it's going to propel your wealth-building journey.
Okay.
So I would get a cheap car for now. Make sure you get a pre-purchase inspection on it. Don't go buying a clunker and then blaming me. But that's going to set you up for success, set you up to get that fully funded emergency in place, begin investing 15%, and get that house paid off. Making $180,000 with no payments, you're going to pay that house off in probably 3 years is my guess. And as young as you guys are, it's going to put you in a great financial spot. Thank you so much for the call, man. That puts this hour of The Ramsey Show in the books. My thanks to all the guys in the booth. We got Christian, Austin, Bob, James, Andrew, who knows who else is there. Zach's back there. And you, America, thanks for listening in. We'll be back real soon. Hey, George Camel here. If you love the show and you want a deeper dive on your money journey, we've got a weekly newsletter that gives you helpful articles and tips on following the Ramsey way. Just go to RamseySolutions.com today to sign up for the newsletter. Again, that's RamseySolutions.com to sign up for our weekly newsletter. Live from the headquarters of Ramsey Solutions, broadcasting from the Pods Moving and Storage Studio, it's The Ramsey Show, where we help people build wealth, do work that they love, and create amazing relationships. I'm George Camel, joined by no one this hour. I'm solo, holding down the fort while our team is across America, changing lives, impacting people. And the number to call if you want to join me is 888-825-5225. I just filmed some real juicy behind-the-scenes Instagram of The Ramsey Show, what we're seeing on the desk, what's going on in the booth. So if you want to go check that out, it's at George Camel with a K on Instagram in the stories for the next, 24 hours, however long the algorithms let it stay alive. So go check that out if you want some behind-the-scenes fun. All right, let's get to the phones. Samantha kicks us off in Spartanburg, North Carolina. Samantha, welcome to The Ramsey Show.
Hey, George, thanks for taking my call.
Happy to. What's going on?
I just had a question do I really need life insurance or can I skip buying it?
Are you single?
No, I'm married.
Okay. So what happens if Samantha, God forbid, something happens to her?
My husband would be fine.
Why is that? He wouldn't need to grieve?
Well,
he wouldn't need to take any time off work?
Maybe to grieve, I'm sure. I mean, but we're kind of in a position, you know, we own our home.
Okay.
And we have no debt. So finances aren't really a problem. And the only thing that I joke with him and say, I feel bad. I feel like I need it because if I die, you know, then wouldn't he love to be a millionaire?
Oh, if you had the life insurance in place.
That, I mean, there's no real reason, I don't think, financially for me to have it.
Well, the time that we would say, hey, you don't need to get term life is if you are self-insured, which means if something happened, you had enough with your assets, with retirement, in the bank, that you wouldn't skip a beat covering the bills and replacing all of the value that Samantha added to this family.
Okay.
And that's not just income, right? That's, oh my gosh, I got to hire some help around the house. Like, I can't do this on my own. And so there's a lot of other people, even stay-at-home moms. We recommend having $250,000 to $400,000 worth of policy on a term life to cover the Mary Poppins-esque solution you would need to cover all the things that stay-at-home moms do, right? And so are you currently working full-time outside of the home?
Not full-time, just part-time. No benefits. My husband carries all the benefits that we need.
Okay. Do you add any value to the home?
Well, God, yeah.
It was a trick question. Yes. And so you've got to think about that aspect, too, of all of the things that you do around the house that he now has to figure out while grieving your loss. And so that's the reason why we recommend having it. And honestly, it is so cheap that I think you'll just sleep better at night knowing there's a big old pad of cash to cover us while we grieve.
Okay.
So how old are you?
That's great advice. At 34.
Okay. You are exactly my age. And I'll tell you, right now, you could get $1 million policy, and it would be like the cost of a pizza.
Wow.
I mean, it is not, it's, I mean, a very nice pizza at that. What's your current income?
Mine is $60,000.
Okay. So if you got a policy that's 10 to 12 times your income for the next 15 or 20 years, you're looking at a $600,000 policy for 15 or 20 years.
Yeah, okay.
Right? So you can jump on RamseySolutions.com and get a term life insurance quote from our friends at Xander Insurance. It's super easy. It will take you legitimately 1 minute. You'll say, hey, here's how healthy I am. Here's my age. Here's what I'm looking at. And we'll spit out a bunch of quotes from a bunch of different companies, and you can get it in place very quickly.
Awesome. Well, thank you so much, George.
Absolutely. Thanks for the call. Great question. And for those of you that are going, hey, I'm not in Samantha's situation, or I don't know that I need it, or no one relies on my income. The moment someone does, or even if you have a bunch of debt and, you know, even think about things like funeral costs and putting that burden on someone to go, oh my gosh, I'm grieving the loss of this person I loved on top of having to, you know, shell out thousands and thousands of dollars. It's a great thing to have in place, and term life is one of the most affordable types of insurance that is out there, and I recommend everybody get it. You want 10 to 12 times your income, and you want a term of about 15 or 20 years, because think about it. If you follow the Ramsey plan, 15 or 20 years from now, you're out of debt with a paid-for house, and you've been investing into retirement for close to 15 years. So you become what we call self-insured, to where you don't need that money because you've got a pile of it yourself. So great question, and always connect with our friends at Xander Insurance. That's who I use for all of my insurance needs. Great folks over there with some great rates because they shop independently. All right, let's move to Boise. Michaela joins us there. What's going on, Michaela?
Hi, George. Thanks for taking my call.
Sure. How can I help?
Me and my husband are getting ready to sell our business, and I guess I'm just wondering if I should put the profit towards debt or if I should save it for a down payment for a house.
Ah, exciting. So what kind of business is this?
It's a hoof trimming business for dairy cattle.
Wow. So specific. I love it.
Yeah.
What are you selling the business for? Do you have a buyer?
Yes, we do.
Okay. So what will be the net profit for you guys?
So the profit will be $38,000.
Awesome. Okay. And you said you've got some debt, but you also want to buy a house. How much debt do you have?
We have about $30,000 in debt.
Okay. And how much money do you have in the bank?
Probably close to $10,000.
Cool. So this is a pretty simple scenario. Now, number one, if you're following the baby steps, the track would be pay off all consumer debt, then fully funded emergency fund, then down payment for a house.
Mm-hmm.
And so if you follow that plan, you're making 38 from the sale, the debt's 30, that leaves you with 8, you already have 10 in the bank. Is 18,000 a fully funded emergency fund for you guys? 3 to 6 months of expenses?
About, yeah.
Perfect. So right after this business is sold, you could be working on that down payment. But I would not use that money as a down payment while you carry $30,000 worth of debt.
Okay.
It's going to slow you down in the long run. And I know you so badly want this house, don't you?
Yes.
You are ready. And you're going to get there in no time when you don't have any payments weighing you down. And when you do get that house, you're going to have one payment to make, and that is the mortgage.
Yeah.
And that is what I call freedom. So how much longer would it take to save up the down payment?
If all of our debts are paid off, not very long.
Booyah. What's your household income?
Well, with the trimming business, it was $90,000, but we just started a new business, so it's going to be close to $120,000.
Oh my gosh, I love it. Okay, and what's the down payment goal you guys have?
I would say anywhere from $15,000 to $20,000.
Oh, that's it?
I don't know, yeah.
Well, I would set a goal, 15-year fixed rate mortgage. That's the only type okay. I'd ever recommend, where the payment's no more than a quarter of your take-home pay. That will help you dictate how much down payment you need. It may be $30,000, it may be $50,000, but making $120,000 with no payments, you're going to be there within, I would say, I'm going to give it less than a year. If you follow these steps, you pay off the debt, you have the emergency funds, start saving up that down payment, in less than a year, you're going to have that down payment, and you're going to step into this house with such peace and such freedom. Thanks for the call. Welcome back to The Ramsey Show. I'm George Camel, co-hosting with no one today, hosting solo. But you can catch me co-hosting on Smart Money Happy Hour and hosting my own brand new YouTube channel. You can go check that out. Just search George Camel with a K over on YouTube. And I recently published a video called Warning, Avoid the Modern Day Gold Rush. And it's because anytime we get spooked in America about the economy and what the government's going to do and is the dollar going to hold its value, people get spooked and the fearmongers come out and they tell you to run and buy gold. So here's a headline from CNBC. Americans think gold beats stocks as a long-term investment. Here's some key points. The share of Americans who think gold is the best long-term investment almost doubled in 2023 to 26%, according to Gallup. The share who prefer stocks declined to 18%. However, stocks are the better wealth generator over long time horizons, according to financial advisors, and gold is typically viewed as a safe haven during times of fear. And here's a quote from Charlie Fitzgerald, who's a certified financial planner. He said, "As a long-term investment, gold is a very poor solution." It's that simple. It's more like speculation. Stocks generally serve as the long-term growth engine of an investment portfolio, financial advisors said. The S&P 500 index of stocks had a 10.43% average annual total return between 1970 and 2022, while gold had a 7.7% return over the same period. So here's the deal. A lot of people are turning to this stuff because they're scared. And I posted this video, and I didn't know that there was a such thing as gold bros, like there are the crypto bros, but they came out in full force in the comment section on this video going like, "Oh, we never said it was an investment. It's a hedge against inflation. And what if I don't trust the government." And I just smile and nod and sleep well at night while they freak out with, I guess, a pile of gold in their bed. I don't know what they're doing with this stuff. And here's the deal. We've joked about it on the show, but if it all went down, right? Because what they're assuming is the stock market tanks. Let's say every company in America went bankrupt and the stock market went to zero and all of our retirement accounts were zero. That is an apocalyptic situation. At that point, when you have a pile of gold, I don't care. I'm looking for food and fuel and shelter and maybe ammo, depending on what's going on. I don't know if the zombies come out at that point. Who knows? But that's really the case. So people that are hanging on to gold are saying it's a hedge against inflation. But long term, we know that the S&P 500, the general stock market, is a way better investment. And therefore, what are you holding gold for? It's a terrible savings account because you still got to go turn it into money. And the gold you bought probably won't sell for what you paid for it unless we're in a terrible economic time, but not at the point of collapse. So I just don't buy this argument. I don't own any gold. I don't even own a gold chain. Okay? I don't think I could rock it if I wanted to. So if I'm in your shoes, I wouldn't be buying gold. And the people who are telling you to run and buy it, they have ulterior motives. And they're usually like old guys yelling at you on TV that you got to go buy gold right now and you can get it from their website or something. So I would avoid it at all costs. And you can go check out that YouTube video, all 8 minutes and 22 seconds, in its full glory and humor over on my YouTube channel. All right, let's take a call from Allison in Richmond, Virginia. Allison, welcome to the show.
Hi, George. Thanks for taking my call.
Absolutely. What's going on?
Well, I have a question. I turned 60, and I was thinking about selling my home and buying an RV.
Why is that?
So I could, I don't know, travel and cut down on expenses.
Are there other people involved here? Are you single, married?
Single.
Okay. So you want to get a big old RV for Allison to traverse the country?
Yes. But not a big one. Like just the little...
Like a little camper situation?
Yeah.
Well, could you test this out and maybe go rent an RV for a week or two before you go sell the house and make this huge life change?
Well, the only problem is the one that I want, you can't really test it out.
There's none available for rent, that style.
No, not, well, maybe I'll have to research it some more, but
okay.
I haven't really seen them.
I would do the homework there. Now, can you pay for this RV in cash?
No, that's why I'm selling the house.
This is what worries me. The house is going to maintain and appreciate in value. That RV is going to go down in value. And that worries me as a retirement plan. So do you have any other investments?
I have a retirement that I receive monthly.
How much is that?
And it's about $2,000.
Is that Social Security or is that a pension?
Oh, pension. No, okay. Yeah.
Okay. So what's your game plan long term in order to retire and have money?
That was kind of like the RV thing. Like I was going to...
Well, you got to eat. You need gas. You got to have some experiences. So are you currently working or are you already retired?
Semi. I do some gig stuff and I work seasonal jobs.
I would put pause on this until we have more information and we have a better financial plan. Do you have a financial advisor that you're working with currently?
No.
I just want to make sure that 80-year-old Allison is happy with the decisions that 60-year-old Allison made.
Okay.
You know what I mean? I don't want you to do this impulsively. You sell the house. Now you lose that appreciating asset. The RV is going down in value. We don't really have anything invested except for this $2,000 pension that's coming in. And all of a sudden, 15 years down the road, we're going, oh my gosh, what did I do? I don't have enough money to buy a house because I put it all in the RV, which is now worth half of what I paid for it. And this is a scary situation.
Okay.
So I would do some homework and I would make sure, because people travel all the time and they don't go buy RVs to do it. So there's a lot of ways to travel the world without having to sell your house to do it. So I just want to make sure you have a place to land, because I can't imagine you're going to travel in an RV for the next 20 years.
I never thought of that part. Yeah.
That's all. I'm just thinking, if I'm in Allison's shoes, I'm thinking long term. I'm thinking, man, I really want to retire with dignity. I want to have money. I don't want to be having to work. I want to get to work. And that's a different mindset and it's a different financial situation. So I think you're on the path. I'm not saying this doesn't happen. I just want to push pause, do a whole lot of homework. You can go meet with one of our a SmartVestor Pro, which are financial advisors that we trust to help you the Ramsey way when it comes to investing. So you can get connected with a SmartVestor Pro at RamseySolutions.com and click on Trusted Pros. And I'd also do some homework on the RV. And I would rent one before I bought one. Because you may get into that thing and say, I hate driving around this boat and having to sleep in a Walmart parking lot. Or you might go, oh my gosh, this is everything I hoped and dreamed for, and here's how much it cost me for 2 weeks, so here's how much it's going to cost me for 6 months. And that's what I'm hoping for you. Well, hey folks, if you've never experienced Smart Conference before, let me tell you, you're missing out on this thing. This is Ramsey's biggest event of the year, and the event is packed with inspiration, motivation, and information. We're talking how to get control of your money, improving your mental health, strengthening your relationships, and building a successful career. So whether you're on baby step 2 or baby step 7 with a paid for house, you're going to leave this event fired up and smarter. So get ready, because our next Smart Conference is happening in Chicago this fall with all of our Ramsey personalities, Dave Ramsey, Rachel Cruz, Dr. John Deloney, Jade Warshaw, Ken Coleman, and myself at Smart Conference weekend, September 15th and 16th. And if you're lucky, you might get to witness a live recording of the Smart Money Happy Hour podcast with Rachel Cruz and I, and you get to be a part of that in the live studio audience. And right now, our early bird general admission ticket price is just $79 for an entire weekend. That's insane. And we've got limited VIP and platinum tickets, so do not wait to get yours. The VIP ticket includes a meet and greet with Rachel, John, Jade, Ken, and me. One of my favorite parts of these events is getting to meet all of you during the breaks, hearing your stories, taking pictures, celebrating your success. It's always a highlight for me. So go to RamseySolutions.com/events to get your tickets today, and I will see you at Smart Conference in Chicago, September 15th and 16th. We'll be right back. Welcome back to the Ramsey Show. I'm George Camel, flying solo today. And I'm not alone. We have a wonderful crowd in the lobby, and I assume they are here for our newest friends on the debt-free stage, Micah and Gia. How are you guys?
Great, George. How are you?
Doing wonderful. Where are you guys from?
North Platte, Nebraska. In the middle of nowhere, there's a little town that we call home.
That's wonderful. Thanks for making the trip all the way to do your debt-free scream.
Absolutely.
Absolutely.
How much debt did you guys pay off?
We paid about $72,000 to $73,000.
All right. And how long did that take?
Roughly about 24-ish months.
All right. And what was your range of income?
When we got married, it was probably about, I was working COVID ward. So probably anywhere between 70 to 95.
Awesome. Okay. What kind of debt was this 72?
It was a mortgage and a house.
Oh my gosh.
Yep.
You paid off your house?
Yep.
Heck yeah.
You guys are too young for that.
No, we're not.
Can I ask you how old you are? Because America's wondering.
I'm 31 and my wonderful wife is 26.
I thought way younger than you. You guys are incredible. Okay, so we got to talk about this. How did you come to going like, we're going to pay this house off at 26 and 31? Most people are going, I'm going to hang on to a mortgage as long as possible. We're going to take out the HELOC to do the renovations and get the investment prop. And you guys just said, we want to be done.
Yeah.
What happened?
It's really my wife's fault. She got me on board, which
That's
has actually
been
a huge blessing to take that journey and have her be encouraging along the way.
How long have you guys been married?
Just about 2.5 years.
Yep.
So you came back from the honeymoon and
nailed it.
You were like, we're getting out of debt.
Yep.
How do you even get a spouse on board after post honeymoon? Like, were you already on board with the Ramsey stuff? Were you guys already debt free? And
yeah. So basically, long story short, what happened was, when I was 15, my dad ended up passing away. It's because he didn't have enough money to buy the meds he needed. And, so when I got married, I said, nope, we're not doing this. So I went to college debt-free. I had siblings that did the Ramsey plan, and I saw that they always had money. And I was like, this, we got to figure this out. And my local church at the time, Mike Michelle led a class. And I was like, yes. So I ended up taking the class when I was in high school. I worked jobs in college. The Lord was just so gracious. And so many things happened. But anyway, we got married. And I remember going to him being like, I want to do this Ramsey plan. And he's like, I don't need no Dave Ramsey in my life. This is common sense. I don't need someone telling me how to do this. And I was like, Lord, how do I do this well? And he said, watch me work. And that was the start. So we got married, and I am like a super nerd. I am like nerdy of the nerd.
Very much.
Yeah. And I'll own it. It's okay. And I was like, Lord, like I want to pay extra on this house and I want to get it paid off. And he wasn't against it. He just was like, all right, we'll do it. And I was working COVID ward and as a nurse, I'm a registered nurse. And Lord was just like, no more than $2,000 on your extra payment. And so we did that. I worked COVID ward, but something changed. My mental health went in the toilet. And my husband finally looked at me and said, I don't care what it costs, you need out. So I went down to work in part time and I didn't get it. I was like, Lord, like, I don't get this. And during that time period, a friend of ours came and lived with us. And because Micah told the Lord we'd never do it. So therefore, we ended up doing it.
Which, mind you, that was 9 months into marriage. So
9 months wow. into marriage, we had a guy come live with us. He's like, hey, I made some mistakes. I need some help. And we were like, absolutely. Come on, man.
So he ended up living with us for a few months. A few months later, we're still plugging away on our debt. And then the Lord's like, hey, by the way, I'm going to put this on your heart. We ended up also bringing in a refugee family from Ukraine. So wow. we went from a family of two to a family of six with a dog overnight.
Oh, my goodness.
For 2 months.
Yeah.
So that was a whirlwind and a half. There was stress that was involved. Times we get frustrated with each other. But in the end, we would never go back on what we did.
Mm. And so during that time, I was still working part time. And what ended up happening was I actually ended up becoming their advocate. I ended up becoming part lawyer.
Wow.
By God's grace, we were able to get them on their feet and with help of the church. But never once did we miss a payment, and never once did we miss an extra payment. And we made that $2,000 every time, even with me missing work, like random things happened, like he got a bonus at work or something happened. And so God was so clear and he was like, nope, you're doing this.
And our grocery bill never ballooned because we had people in our church that partnered with Salvation Army. So we were also getting food donations on a weekly basis.
That's incredible.
So like we said, we haven't missed anything. Nothing ever changed.
So you guys were super faithful. Community showed up. God showed up on top of all of your hard work and diligence.
Yep.
And paid this thing off in 2 years.
Well,
2 years.
And then after that, about 3 weeks after, we ended up doing a camp called Royal Family Kids Camp. Royal Family Kids Camp is a camp that loves kids in the foster care system who have seen the worst of the worst. We literally helped a child who literally watched their family get shot and then got shot themselves. And in this camp, what we do is we treat them like royals for a week. And we love on them. So I went as a nurse. He went as a big camper. And God did so much. We actually have to pay to go to the camp so that way the kids don't have to go or have to pay to go. And God allowed that to happen. And so we got to do that, and it was so much fun. So if you guys see, we're wearing shirts that say Make Moments Matter. And if I'm going to be really honest, I'm going to have an honest wife moment for a second. Last week when we were talking about like how we wanted to do this and what we wanted to share, my lovely husband comes to me and he says, hey, I think we need to wear Make Moments Matter shirts. And I was like, babe, don't you think we might want to wear something a little nicer or something? And he's like, but babe, that's the whole reason we did this. The whole reason we did this is because we wanted to make moments matter. We want to be able to serve servants and be available for people.
Wow.
And so that's why we do this. We do this because we want to make moments matter, not only for our family and future generation, but we want to be able to be available for people because never once did our giving budget change. Never once did our payments stop. And this isn't any like prosperity gospel. This is not because, oh, we did this because now Jesus will bless us. That's not how this works. Like there was a lot of times I was scratching my head being like, I don't know how we're going to do this, but okay. Like, all right, we'll do it. And the Lord was just so, so faithful.
Well, now that you guys are debt free with no payments, you can make those moments matter. You realize very early on that it was never about the money and this debt payoff goals. What could we do if we didn't have any payments?
Exactly.
What kind of life would we leave? How many people could we help? And so you guys are such an inspiration. I'm so proud of you. What do you tell that couple that's sitting out there with the mortgage and probably a bunch of debt and they're going, yeah, but we're not Micah and Gia. That's not us. What do you tell them the key to getting out of debt is?
I mean, I know we've heard it said, you stick to the budget, and it's not so much your financial decision as it is your lifestyle choice. Right. So for us, make moments matter. That's kind of become our lifestyle choice, as well as serving the servants. But for the spouses who may not necessarily be on board right away, as someone who also wasn't on board right away, the Lord works wonderfully when someone is persistent and they're persistent in prayer with that.
Mm. Yeah.
And when they get on board, it's all the more exciting because then I caught it and go, okay, yes. What else can we do to help push this out? So it's really, I mean, it's That's hard work.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But in the end, it's worth it.
I'm curious, what's the house worth?
Right now, I think sitting on the market's like 140-ish.
130, 140, 40? Roughly.
It's all yours.
It's all ours.
It's all ours.
The next step for you guys is Baby Steps Millionaires as you continue to live and give like no one else. So we've got the live and give box for you, including Dave's bestseller, Baby Steps Millionaires, the Total Money Makeover, so you can get someone else's journey started, and of course, 1 year to Financial Peace University to go through this. So proud of you guys. You ready?
Yeah.
Absolutely.
It's the moment we've all been waiting for. It's you Micah. And Gia, $73,000 paid off, house and everything in 24 months, making 70 all the way up to 90. Count it down. Let's hear a debt-free scream.
Three, two, one.
We're debt-free! Oh, I hope you're watching on YouTube because this is a beautiful picture of what love and freedom looks like. And did you hear that? They hit a very deep why. It was more than just about money. It was more than just about them. It was what they could do for their family, for their community, for the kingdom. And I'm so inspired by this amazing young couple out there. And if they can do it, you can too, America. What's holding you back? Do you need a deeper why? Do you need a bigger shovel? Go do what it takes, because that kind of freedom is worth it every time. This is The Ramsey Show. Welcome back to The Ramsey Show. Our scripture of the day comes from Isaiah 43:19. See, I am doing a new thing. Now it springs up. Do you not perceive it? I am making a way in the wilderness and streams in the wasteland. Justin Vernon of Bon Iver, one of my favorite artists, said, "You never have to change your scene when you're always comfortable with evolving." Love it. I'm inspired by our last debt-free scream. And it reminded me of my story 10 years ago when I started here at Ramsey and I was $40,000 in debt. I was bright-eyed, bushy-tailed, and very broke. And the system, I realized, was designed to keep me broke. I did everything society told me to do, what my parents told me to do. My parents were immigrants from the Middle East. They came, they adapted to the American culture very quickly and collected some consumer debt. And I thought, I was real frustrated. I got real cynical. I was anxious. I was a little bit hopeless, going like, I'm $40,000 in debt and I did everything society told me to do and life just hasn't worked out magically because I went to this right school and took out the student loans and I'm using my credit cards trying to build my score and yet I don't feel like I'm winning financially. I'm not getting ahead. I'm not building my net worth. I'm just making credit card companies rich and I'm under the guise of my 2% cash back and my Delta Sky Miles card. And so when I realized, hey, it's my fault, and it's not all my fault, but it is my responsibility. What am I going to do next? And starting here at Ramsey Solutions in 2013, $40,000 in debt, following the baby steps, going through Financial Peace University, I paid off that consumer debt in 2 years, following the debt snowball method, got my emergency fund in place. I began investing into our 401k here at Ramsey, and I realized, oh my gosh, I don't have to play this game anymore. I don't need the credit score. I don't need to hope to do the credit card churning to get the points to hope to go on the vacation one day. I can just save up and pay for my own dang stuff and not have to wait on the credit card companies to bless me with their cashback freaking rewards. Oh, and I don't have to have a mortgage for 30 or plus years. I can get a 15-year mortgage and then pay that off early because I don't have any debt and I have control of my income. That's a game changer. So that helped me realize, oh my gosh, you can buck the system entirely. And on the other side of that is financial freedom, is financial peace, is life on my terms, is margin, is options, is joy. And man, that was a game changer for me when I realized that. And that's what every single debt-free screamer up here realizes. And what you realize is it's way more than money. Paying off debt is just the secret we get you to get up on the stage. But what you do is you change your life because you realize, oh, I can apply this in every other area. And what can I do without payments? It's not about the money. It's about what the money can do. It's just a tool. And I can now bless others. I can give outrageously. I can retire early. I can retire with dignity. And that's what life is all about to me. It's not about just storing up a bunch of money. It's about way, way more than that. So I hope you guys get that. When you hear these debt-free screams, you feel it in their spirit. Something changes, something visceral, something cathartic. And man, there is such freedom in bucking the system and going, oh my gosh, I can rent a car with a debit card and just pay for stuff and not have to worry about what I bought 3 months ago and do pay later. I can just pay now and be done with it and move on with my life, leaving mental space and emotional energy and financial margin to do the things I want to do. Man, that's freedom. And so if you want a piece of that, that's what this show is all about. Join Financial Peace University if you want to dig into that. I'm leading a class starting June 20th virtually. You can join at fpu.com. Let's get to the phones. Letitia joins us in Washington, D.C. Letitia, what's going on?
Hey, George. This is so crazy that I get to actually speak to you.
It's crazy for me, too.
All right, let me get straight to the point. My husband and I are actually in $389,000 worth of debt.
Oh.
Most of it is student loans. Yeah, that's how we feel when we look at it. I'm currently working as a CNA at a hospital, and he works for the regulatory authority. We want to know, he's thinking that I should go back and go to nursing school, and we should do it while we're trying to get out of debt, because, you know, once I get a nursing degree, my income would increase exponentially. However, I feel like we should tackle our debt first, and then, you know, maybe we could use my, when I go back, that income that I get, we could use it for baby step three on baby step 3B instead. So I'm just trying to see which is the smarter decision. We live in D.C., so, you know, our expenses are kind of high anyway. Well, we live in the D.C. area, so they're high. Anyways.
How did we go this far into student loan debt? Is this a mix of your student loans?
It's both of ours. He has a bachelor's and a master's, and I have a bachelor's in social work. He has one in business admin. I mean, he's using his degree. I am currently not using mine, but we also did go to private Adventist colleges.
Oh,
and,
my,
you know,
goodness.
Private schools.
How much student loans did you take?
So I think his master's was about, I think it was like 90,000, I want to say, and undergrad was like 30 grand a year. For both of us.
I'm just confused how this adds up to 400 grand.
So interest, we ignored it for a really long time.
Boy.
So it's been building. Yeah.
Okay.
So we're very deep in a hole. And I don't think that we should.
What's your household income?
Because if I go to school, so I'm 120 gross. So we bring about 75 a month, I think. But we have four kids too. So two.
Oh boy, it's a party over there. Okay.
Yeah.
How much money do you guys have in the bank?
Just our $1,000 emergency fund.
Do you have any other kind of debt?
Just a few medical bills. One of our kids was, our latest child was in the NICU for a while. So that bill, you know, they charged like it's a luxury hotel, so it's pretty large.
Okay.
Yeah.
So here's what I'm thinking. You guys are in a hole.
Mm-hmm.
And right now your husband's like, let's just keep digging and we'll get to China eventually if we keep digging. I thought that as a kid. Doesn't work like that. And so I don't want you to dig this hole any further. Because the fallacy is, well, we'll go to nursing school, we'll add another 150 grand, but then my income will go up by another 50 grand.
Well, we were thinking about going the associate's route where we could pay out of pocket. It's only about 5,000 a semester, and I would get my associate's because I can still sit for the NCLEX that way, like to actually become a registered nurse. But if I go and get an associate, that would take all the money that we're using.
And you're able to go to nursing school, take care of four kids, and still keep your full-time job?
I don't think so, but...
So that's what worries me, is you lower your income while this debt is accumulating interest to hope that years down the line, we increase this income. So I think what we need to do is find other ways to increase income right now. until we clean this mess up. Then once we clean it up, we can look at cash flowing school. But we have cash flowed enough school at this point. I mean, we've taken out enough debt. We tried the school route. Yeah. Let's try the work our tails off route. And so we need to get this income up, because 389 making 120, that scares me. Making 200, trying to pay 390. Okay, now we got, we're cooking now. We can put 100 at the debt, be done with this thing in under 4 years. And if you've heard our friend Jade Warshaw's story, fellow Ramsey personality, they paid off, what, $465,000 worth of debt in 7.5 years. And so your story may look more similar to theirs, where it doesn't take 2 years. It may take four or 5 years. But they also got their income up like crazy. They were doing 17 side hustles.
So just work? Because I was thinking maybe if we could lower our expenses, maybe moving to a cheaper cost of living area.
I mean, that's a huge key. Can you guys do that with your jobs?
We were thinking about relocating to Georgia, where our family, where we have some family there. And my husband's job is remote, so it goes with him wherever he goes, as long as he doesn't leave the United States.
I love it. So hey, if you guys are willing to uproot your life to then shave off 20, 30 grand a year, that will change everything. Yeah. And so if you're willing to do that, I would do it.
Yeah, I don't think he's willing. So
because you guys are going to run out of steam at this rate in D.C.,
we are already losing steam. He's completely out of hope. So I hear you.
Well, that's going to be a step in giving you guys hope. And I also want to gift you 1 year of Financial Peace University. I want you and your husband to go through it, because you guys need some pep in your step. Yes, you need some income. Yes, but you also need to see the light at the end of this tunnel. So hang on the line. Austin will pick up and we'll gift you 1 year of Financial Peace University, as well as 1 year of Every Dollar Plus. There's a paycheck planning tool in there that I want you to use, a financial goals tool to show you when you're going to become debt-free, how to get there faster, what you could do with an extra $1,000, $2,000 a month in income. And I hope that gives you the hope and motivation that you need to stay the course. And I can't wait for you guys to come and do your debt-free scream and tell us how it all went sooner rather than later. That puts this hour of The Ramsey Show in the books. Until next time, spend wisely, save intentionally, and give generously. Hey, George Camel here. If you love the show and you want a deeper dive on your money journey, we've got a weekly newsletter that gives you helpful articles and tips on following the Ramsey way. Just go to RamseySolutions.com today to sign up for the newsletter. Again, that's RamseySolutions.com to sign up for our weekly newsletter.